Alrighty. Yep. Yeah, we're good. We're good to go. Boom. Shakalaka.
All right. Here we go. Welcome, everyone, if anybody's on yet.
Right.
Hello. You know, so here we go. Another tech show. We missed last week, but we are back this week. I had some problems last week. It was all my fault. I had problems last week. I lost track of time. We're getting such long days now that I don't associate the sun setting, it just seems like, you know, it's like, oh, it's only 3 o'clock, but yeah, it ended up being like 6:30, so I screwed that one up. So, but anyway, we are here. So how you been, Steven?
Good. Good. Working. Starting to get busy. We had a open house, which is basically where they just get a bunch of demo bikes. And food and like other random stuff that, you know, that have to do with motorcycles. And they just let people test ride a bunch of demo bikes.
Nice.
Yeah, so we had that. So, I mean, obviously, sounds more fun than it actually is because I was an employee. You know, when you're an employee, that's usually meaning you're busy. But surprisingly, I actually got to sit around and do a lot of nothing. They had a bike wash there, and it was pretty hilarious, the incident with that. So I don't know who they hired for the bike wash. I don't know. I mean, I saw the guy, but it was some older gentleman, portly fella, little chubby, had the kind of look of a sex offender. He did not look like someone that I would be okay meeting for the first time randomly. So I mean, he was a nice guy, but he had like the nappy, curly, greasy hair, like long hair. Like a big beard and a shirt that said Got Lube on the back.
Oh.
So the girls, it was a bikini wash, bike wash. Mm-hmm. So the girls he was hiring was off Craigslist. Now imagine if you're one of these younger, prettier Craigslist girls showing up and seeing that guy. How would you feel? You know what I mean?
Yeah. That'd be creepy.
Their bike wash was a total fail. The girl was there for, he called four girls. They said they were showing up. Only one showed up. And, the one that showed up said she was going to go get some suntan lotion and never came back.
so that went over like shit.
Yeah, and the funniest part was, I mean, the guy didn't look professional at all, like I said. He should have looked a little bit more professional, you know. Mm-hmm. And his sign for bike wash was just like a square piece of paper, like construction paper, and like Sharpie bikini bike wash on it. You know what I mean? So this guy's girl flaked on him about 10 minutes after showing up. She left. Up and left, never came back. So he was sitting there for about 3 hours with that sign that said, wet shirt, bikini, bike wash. And there was no girls around. So it's just kind of like, is that guy going to be the guy washing your bike? Like, this is just creepy. And like I said, the Got Lube shirt just did not help. But wow. Yeah, so that happened. So that was pretty funny to laugh at, you know what I mean? So I got to see a lot of bikes. Oldest bike I saw, someone brought, I don't know what type, I just know it was a 1937. So, mm-hmm. A very old bike, vintage.
That's an old bike.
Yeah, very, that's an old, yeah. That's classic. So, yeah, anything with you? Anything fun?
Nothing. I did a couple of computer builds the past couple of weeks and then some repairs in that, but it's been a little busier, so that's good.
Oh, okay. I actually had a guy, I forgot about that. Some guy had messaged me. He called me. He wanted to build a Sonic computer. And he's like, so how much would that cost me? I'm like, generally, if you want a decent gaming computer, you're going to be looking to spend around $400 to $500, like minimum. Like, if you want something that can play 1080p, any game on the market for the most part, you're going to want to spend around that price just on your tower, you know? He more had in mind about $120. I was like,
oh, that's tough.
Yeah, I was like, dude, a decent CPU is going to cost 60. I was like, that's not really going to work. You know what I mean? So he said that if $400 is what I can do, I told him he says he's got some, he's like, I got some old monitors. They're nice ones. They're like 15-inch monitors. And I was just like, oh God. It was like that's like a square monitor. Like, no one even uses those anymore, right?
Yeah, not that I've seen.
Yeah, I was like, all the kids nowadays use 1080p full HD monitors that, you know, a 24-inch is the standard nowadays, minimum. So, I mean, he's not going to be using that, but I was like, well, if you are going to be putting your son on this 15-inch monitor, his son's like 13, so he won't really notice, you know? If you are going to put him on this little 14-inch or 15-inch monitor, you don't really need a more powerful computer, you know what I mean? Like, an R7 360 is going to actually be pretty overpowered for, what is that going to be, like a 680p monitor or something like that?
Yeah, it's probably like 1024 by 768, you know what I mean? It's probably just,
So I was like, that graphics card is going to be overpowered for it. So I was like, maybe I can squeeze something out of it, you know, a lot less performing, since you're not going to be using a 1080p 24-inch monitor. I can get you something to get it. I forgot to message him back. Forgot to get back to him. But I haven't really been into the building computers lately because I've been busy just with other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I would turn down what seemed like to be a actual build, you know, like someone who's actually going to go through with it. I hate wasting my time on people on Craigslist. And I'm pretty sure you feel the same way at times.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When they come from Craigslist, it's almost... Yeah. It's like more than half. I would say like 9 times out of 10, it doesn't go well or it doesn't happen.
Yep.
Maybe even like 9.5 times out of 10 from Craigslist. Yeah, yeah. That's a tough one.
Yeah, and they're flakes, and they'll waste like 2 hours of your time. You know what I mean? And because I get 3 or 4 hours after work, and then I'm in bed. If I'm lucky, usually it's only about 2.5 hours. I don't want to waste that hour, 2 hours that I got talking to somebody that isn't going to have me build their computer, you know?
Yep. That's going to suck your time, you know?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So I don't want to do that. But it's, you know, you do what you can do, I guess. You know, if you want to build, you'll chase it. If you don't want to build, you won't. So in the order I have it, I had the PlayStation one up first. So what is this? You can go ahead and explain.
Okay, so the PlayStation View is like a alternate cable, and it looks kind of interesting. It looks like, so PlayStation, from what I can tell, is getting into the cable market and going up against the big cable providers. And I actually think this is interesting because the cable companies provide the internet, so it's going to be funny to have a streaming service.
This is going to be over the internet.
Yeah, and it's cable channels. It's not like Netflix, which already has their problems with cable providers, but this is going to be providing cable channels, just like the cable company, and the cable company is going to provide the internet.
So what are they
going
to do about data caps?
That's what I was wondering. What the hell happens there? So what if the cable company just starts to say, oh yeah, by the way, we're going to put a 1 gigabyte or a 10 gigabyte data cap on there, then what's PlayStation going to do with their PlayStation cable? So this is kind of an interesting thing. Mm-hmm. No contract either. It sounds like you can just...
And I take it you have to have a PlayStation for this to work.
Yeah, yeah. I'm guessing a PS4 is what I understand. Yeah, you got to have a PS4.
Wow, this is surprising to see this come out of PlayStation, because when Xbox One came out, everyone was like, oh, this is a TV console. You know what I mean? It's an entertainment center thing, where they had it linked to, you know, everything, your movies, like it links up to your TV, everything plugs into your Xbox. You were thinking of it more of just being a souped up cable box. Now, turns out PlayStation's actually going to be your cable box, not Xbox. Xbox, I guess, I don't know, either they're lagging behind in the taking over your entertainment center, or maybe they just want to stick to gaming. They probably should have thought about that before releasing the Xbox One, but, you know.
Yeah.
Either way, yeah. I don't know. Once you said it's going to be a streaming service over the internet, that just makes me think of the whole thing that Netflix has gone through. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Except this is right there. I mean, they're providing actual channels just like cable. So this is going to be... I think this is going to take a shit. I can't imagine a cable company being cool with this. And they have a lot of money. Probably more money than Sony.
Mm-hmm. So, quick question. As their prices, what are you thinking this compared to actual cable prices?
And for me, this is about the same.
Cable doesn't use the internet. You guys remember that?
Right,
this uses your internet. So anybody watching TV on your PlayStation will be taking up your bandwidth.
Yep.
So their best bet is to have extremely competitive prices, which 70 channels for $35... That seems roughly the same as what I'm paying too.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, I'm curious. So if you had like a VoIP system that you were using for telephone as well, and then somebody was on the phone using VoIP, you were trying to watch the television, and then you have another computer downloading, you're going to have a pretty substantial internet connection in order to handle all of that at once, especially if you start getting into HD channels. And I can't imagine that these wouldn't have HD channels.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be dumb.
Yeah, no, if they're not streaming in HD, I mean, no one's going to go for it, because Netflix streams in HD, everything streams in HD, your cable companies will give you cable in HD. One thing I will say is that when my internet does go out due to shitty cable service providers, like every now and then my internet will shut out for like an hour, you know what I mean? My cable still works fine. So at least I can watch TV.
Not with this.
Yeah, not with this. This is internet dependent for PlayStation's cable stuff. So and you know what? Now I will say this $30 a month comes with Cartoon Network, which is really the only channel I care about, believe it or not. I watch Adult Swim. That's basically it. That's always what my TV is on. So what I'm looking at from their TV channels that they have selected, they actually look like they have better selection comparing to what where I'm at, Cox Digital Cable, comparing their lowest package to this lowest package. It seems like there's a few channels that are included in here that you would want in that cable provider's package that aren't there. So you have to go one tier up in order to get them. Like, literally, I'm paying $15 extra a month because I want Cartoon Network.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Just because that one channel doesn't exist in their lowest package. Because, frankly, no one in my house but me watches TV. And I use it for when I get off work and I want to lay down in bed. I watch TV for like an hour before I go to bed. You know what I mean? 30 minutes or so. And I watch Cartoon Network. That's usually because it's on Adult Swim, watch Family Guy and all that stuff. But this seems to have all the Nickelodeon channels, MTV, Cartoon Network, AMC, Animal Planet. It's actually pretty good. Discovery. Mm-hmm. So this actually has a good amount of like the wanting to watch stuff. Spike TV, yep. Sci-fi. This definitely has some good cable packages for only $30. That's their $30 package that comes with 55 channels. And it has National Geographic Channel as well. I wish I saw the Science Channel on here. That'd be super sweet. Oh,
yeah,
there it is.
Yeah,
it does have the Science Channel.
It does on the Slim?
Yeah, the Slim one. Slim.
Oh, shoot. That's awesome.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so their Slim package is looking a lot better than what my cable provider offers for their $30 package. This has all the channels you'd want, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. MTV 1 and 2 as well.
I just wonder what Cox would do to you if you signed up for this and they were able to... Because I'm sure they can tell, you know, what data's coming across. I wonder if they wouldn't try to throttle it or reroute the stream in order to give you worse quality. You know, not on purpose, of course. They wouldn't do it on purpose, but
okay.
But I wonder if that would actually end up happening in this situation.
Well, Cox has actually been fairly good to me. The only time they got on us was my roommate has a freaking issue with torrenting. I don't torrent shit.
That's
why my computer doesn't have viruses, kids.
Yep.
Don't
that's
torrent
exactly.
shit. Don't illegally download shit if you ain't supposed to. If you're gonna do it on a phone or a tablet, so that way that shit gets viruses, not your computer. But either way, I don't. That's the only time we've really heard from them. One time, they told us we hit a 300 gigabyte max cap. We went over our 300 gigabyte cap for a month. That's what our cap is at my house for my connection, is around 300 gigs. I don't know how they did it. I'm pretty sure they were just saying that because that's when the whole Netflix fiasco was going on.
Mm-hmm.
When they were telling Netflix to, hey, you have to pay us more because your users are using up a ridiculous amount of bandwidth. So I'm pretty sure that's when they hit us. That's when that happened. But at the same time, I don't think we've ever had that problem ever since. But my roommate, like I said, had a torrenting issue and downloading issue. I mean, like 10, 20 gigs a day. You know what I mean?
Jeez.
Yeah,
that's a lot of shit.
Mm-hmm. And then plus you have me on my computer, and I do I do downloads, you know. I download things I need, games, updates, stuff like that. But I don't, he sits there and literally like thousands of animes, mangas, shows, anything he wants to download. He just sits there in torrents all day. And he still does it. I have no idea why. I just look at him, I'm like, dude, you could download Cody and just stream anything you want to watch ever. You know what I mean? Or quit being so cheap and pay for Crunchyroll or something, you know?
Right, yeah, yeah. Especially, yeah. I've heard Crunchyroll is fantastic.
He's had it.
Oh, yes?
Yeah, for like 2 months. He said he didn't like it, though. He said there was issues with it that he didn't like. And I'm pretty sure the hardcore anime fans would be able to point out those issues. I don't know them. Because, frankly, like I said, I don't really get to watch TV unless it's before I go to bed, and that's usually Family Guy. But, yeah, if they find a way to make it not so internet-dependent or not count against your data bandwidth, I think I might buy a PS4 just to have $30 a month cable. And then dump some more money into my internet bill and go up a tier to, I think I'd be up at a 300 meg connection.
Wow.
It's like, I think it's like $120 a month.
Man, that is the one nice thing about living in a big city over a small city. I cannot get that for nothing.
Yeah.
Well, maybe a commercial, you know, a commercial, like a business internet connection. But I still think here the fastest they go is 100 megs.
I
don't think anything goes any faster than that. But 300 is, that's a lot.
Well, you can go their business connection. It's like 500. Hmm. It's still not gigabit internet, though. I mean, come on.
Well, that would be nice, but yeah. You'll probably end up getting that before I do, I would imagine, in Las Vegas.
I would hope so, but we're having some issues out here, so I don't know how that's going to work. I'm trying to see what their offers was in pricing for their internet real quick. So I'm on my Cox Digital Cables thing. But I know that I right now currently have 60... I pay for the 60 down, like... 30 up, but I actually get like 120 down and like only like 25 up. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's not the complete advertised speed. It's kind of varying a little bit. But like my download speed's ridiculous. It's almost double the speed of what it used to be. It's 120 now. But my upload speed's still only about 25. So,
and I get 20, yeah, I get 20 down and 0.8 up.
Oh my god, that's hurtful.
That's the fastest I can get.
There's no way to get faster uploads either, is there?
No. It's where I live, it's DSL's the only option, so that's about as fast as currently DSL can go. Oh. Or at least here. At least where I'm at.
Oh wow. Yeah. Okay, so what I pay is for my internet is, yeah, see, here's my TV. $53 a month. And I had to pay that over the $30 a month package just because I wanted Cartoon Network. But the $53 a month one does come with all HD channels. So like all of your channels you can watch in standard definition. And if you put a zero in front of the number, it's all HD channels. So like 56 is Comedy Central. 1056 is going to be high definition Comedy Central. You know what I mean? So that does come with the HD channels and everything. My internet is $76 a month, and that, I believe, is a total. They give me, I'm not sure if I'm paying for 70 or 100 down. I can't remember. But I know that I get about 120. So.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it is. It is nice. I will say that, man. It's definitely nice. But, it, like I said, in order to, like, up my upload speed, I'd have to fucking up my package, which is, like, another, like, $30 or $40, which... If I got rid of my cable, I would do. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I'd be rocking either the 150 or the 300 connection.
Yeah,
it'd be that's nice.
What? So 300 down. Well, how much up do you get?
I think that one's like 80 or 100 up.
Oh,
it's like really, man, yeah. And then the one underneath that is 150 down and like 50 up.
Wow.
Yeah. So, like, I'm right underneath that one. I'm at 120 up and or down and 30 up. But it's only I only ever get 25 up, I've noticed.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyways, what's your next one? PC World Storage on Steroids. Intel Beach.
Yeah. Okay. Look at that. Yeah, they're going to they're working on interconnect, I guess, is probably the best way, and enabling storage to be as fast as RAM. So this will be non-volatile, yeah, like an SSD, but it'll run at near RAM speeds.
Who said? Someone just said. Notorious Gatby said, "Get fiber." Yeah, if I could pay them to lay down fiber in my area and Mike's area, I would. But that's really expensive.
And yeah, unfortunately.
I also feel like your city, your county, your state's gonna have to be okay with them laying down fiber too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what are they planning to do?
Well, there looks like they're. From what I understand, they're trying to make something that a storage that actually plugs into a DDR4 slot, but it's non-volatile, so it doesn't erase after you shut the power off. So you could have, just an SSD sitting in a RAM slot that the processor is actually able to talk to it at RAM speeds. Now you'd have to have the storage technology would have to be able to deliver to read or write at those speeds, which right now I don't think we're there yet. I still think the fastest SSD is something around 2 gigs or something, isn't it? If I recall, but 2 gigs a second. But anyway, this opens it up for the direct pipeline between the CPU and storage via like a RAM stick, a 288-pin DDR4. So I think that is like incredible because I'm always looking for faster storage. Of course, the software would have to be able to take advantage of it too because if the software can't use it, then it's not going to do anything anyway.
Well, the difference between, like you were saying, the RAM slots and the PCI slots is the PCI slots are going to go through the... some of them go through the hub, some of them go directly through and then talk to the CPU. But the difference between that and the RAM, this is for people that might not know, your RAM talks directly to your CPU through the memory controller, which in Intel CPUs is on board in the chipset or in the chip. So that's why RAM is super fast, because it just goes straight into your it's got its own memory controller. So I'm wondering if the new CPUs will probably try to include a second memory controller simply for storage and kind of create a type of plug like PCI, except it'd be more of a memory DIMM slot along the PCI area. That way it's connected directly and goes straight to the CPU, and that CPU is going to have its own dedicated memory controller for storage, not for RAM. But I don't know. I'm pretty sure they're going to start off just like what they did with CPUs, where the memory controller used to not be on the CPU. It used to be in the motherboard. Yep. So they might start like, AMD's FX series still do that. You notice that big fucking heat sink right above where your graphics card goes in that gets extremely hot? That's the memory controller. That's what talks to your RAM, which is why a lot of times Intel's will also pull over AMD is because they have much better communication with RAM over AMD at the moment. So like because of that that memory controller being inside of the CPU, that's why if you do any like what is it called? What are the RAM tests called? The RAM preview, RAM test that lets you.
I
test
know.
RAM?
IDA 64 has one, but there is MemTest as well too.
Okay, MemTest.
The DOS one, the one that you boot into. Yep, that's MemTest x86.
I know there's one that you don't have to boot into, one that you can just run at your desktop. An Intel system will score double the score of an AMD system.
Oh, yeah. It makes it look like something's wrong with AMD is what it does.
Well, the Northbridge on an AMD runs at like 2600 megahertz. Meanwhile, you have the Northbridge on the Intels will run at like 4200.
And then they can just eat data. Those Intel CPUs love the data from RAM.
It's a joke.
Yeah.
This sounds expensive. He was saying it's a joke at fiber. He was talking about the fiber joke.
It will be expensive. That's for damn sure.
Have you seen how much Intel charges for an SSD? Like, that's a preview of what their extremely fast SSD is going to be. I mean, look at Intel's M.2 and PCI drives. Those things are expensive as shit. $500?
Although I bought I had to buy DDR4 RAM the other day for a system. I built a Skylake system last weekend, and I picked up 32 gigabytes for $99 of DDR4. Really? Yeah, and
four it's sticks a G. Or two? It's,
two sticks, okay. Two 16s, and it was G-scale, so, and it was 2400 megahertz DDR4, and I couldn't even believe that 32 gigs for $99.99, and it wasn't even on special, it wasn't a sale, it was just a Newegg deal, and I remember the first time I remember buying 2 megabytes for $200.
Oh, so. I remember, not even, you know, like what you were saying right now. But also, even, what was it, 2 years ago, year and a half ago, 8 gigs of DDR4 memory was 70 to 80, or DDR3, I mean, was $70 to $80. Mm-hmm. Do you remember that, like, a year and a half ago, 2 years ago? 8 gigs
that
of
DDR... That was, like, half that.
When I first built my computer, yeah, when I first built, like, my first computer, was an FX8320, I needed 8 gigs of friggin' RAM. It was $80 for 2 4-gig sticks. Like $76 on sale, and then I bought another set of 2 4-gig sticks because I wanted, you know, to fill all of the slots, and yeah, same thing. It was like $72, $68. Now it's like $30.
Yeah.
Even DDR4 is like $30. You know what I mean?
Yeah. DDR4 fell a lot faster than I thought.
Oh yeah, that dropped super quick. Yeah.
It's almost like as soon as they Haswell E on the X99, it was really high, and then as soon as Skylake came out, DDR4 dropped.
Yeah, well, they had to make it seem more appealing to go for Skylake over Haswell. I mean,
yeah,
the motherboards
true, right?
are already
right.
more expensive. Imagine paying a lot more for a motherboard, then paying a lot more for RAM. You know what I mean? And then paying $10 to $15 more for the CPU. You know. So if they drop the prices of RAM, and that's why I've been, you know, same with you, I'm pretty sure I've been able to put these Skylake builds together for reasonable prices, you know, and it makes it a lot more appealing.
Cheaper. And they are fast. I used a 6700K this last time, and that's a pretty fast CPU. I was surprised how fast.
Yeah.
It's a good chip.
$5,000 for 10 gigabytes of super SSD. Wrecked. You know what? I bet if you tried to buy a super SSD, like, that's not even on the market, you could probably do it for $5,000. I'm pretty sure you could find a company that'll build you one for $5,000.
Mm-hmm. There was somebody that did a 14-terabyte one, and I think it was around $5,000. It was enterprise only, but it was 14 terabytes. So, yeah, I mean, they're out there.
Oh.
I don't know what the hell you'd do with 14 terabytes of storage, but...
I like the little diagram they drew here. Future Xeon processor, and it just shows a line sticking up with the two pieces of RAM.
Yeah.
That's funny. Well, we'll see how Intel storage goes.
Somebody spent a lot of time on that, didn't they? I think I probably could have drawn that.
I know, in MS Paint.
Right.
Okay, so our next topic is
I do want to talk about one quick thing though before we move on. As far as Intel goes, you know, with all the layoffs recently, that's unfortunate, and that's terrible that they closed that, you know, what was it, like 12 or 13,000 jobs, and they got a little porky and they had to cut a lot of people, and that is sad. And my, you know, definitely my heart goes out to everybody that lost their jobs. That's too bad, you know what I mean?
Wait, who lost their jobs? You
know? Intel laid off. They laid off like 14,000 people.
They pulled a Microsoft
just recently. Yeah, Here, let me get the details.
I think it was last. About this. Someone was asking about Clash Royale. Looking it up.
It's at the end of this month. 12,000 jobs. They confirmed Tuesday that it's eliminating 12,000 jobs beginning immediately. So, I mean, literally at the end of this month. It's global. It's not just the United States. It's global. But I bet they were pretty good paying jobs as well too. So that's too bad that kind of stuff happens. But it said they were getting they finally were giving up on some of the desktop area and. Being that desktops have kind of slowed down since, or they haven't increased as much since tablets came out, and so they have to cut some fat, which is too bad. They're going to notify the employees on April 25th if they don't have a job. So, like, literally, April 25th, what's that, Monday?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, tomorrow, people are going to go to work, and they're going to find out that they don't have a job. And by April 29th, I mean, it's just crazy. What do you do? I guess that's what a big business has to make profit, and that's what they're doing to make their profit. But it's just too bad that there is a layoff in general. But I guess it's the way it goes.
Yeah, that's sad. Intel's gonna abandon the desktop area because they have no competition. They don't need people around to make sure that they have the top-notch shit, because AMD's not giving them a fight.
No, that's another problem there too. Yeah, it's like they can be lazy now, and
that's not good. No, so hopefully, if Intel does step down a little bit from desktops because they're fading, then maybe AMD can pull the catch-up game and make Intel really have to work for their money to get it back. So that would be cool. So rivalry between AMD and Intel peaked during the first decades of the 2000s. So I'm reading the AMD is resurrecting itself as a formidable rival to Intel. What happened?
And this kind of tails into Intel layoff standpoint. That AMD is kind of resurrecting itself as well too. So I'm kind of curious as when they finally punch with Zen. Mm-hmm.
Better be a really hard punch.
there's reports here saying that if the punch is hard enough, that it could start to pull them back into an actual competitor to Intel.
Yeah.
Where unfortunately they really haven't been in several years. They haven't been a competitor.
Well,
but now
they haven't been a competitor when it comes to desktop computing.
Yeah.
But when it comes to consoles,
they're
heavy competitors, because no one makes an APU like AMD. End of story. They just don't. And then on top of it, even though AMDs are known for being hot and power hungry, the amount of wattage that those APUs can consume, with the amount of high-end hardware they have in them, is just incomparable to it, like a CPU, desktop CPU and graphics card, or even a laptop. You know what I mean? These consoles are extremely power efficient, and I mean, they can play a lot of games at 900, 1080p, 30 to 60 FPS, you know what I mean, at medium, low, medium detail settings. So, and Intel's never been able to do a good HD graphics, you know what I mean, as far as it, when it comes to having like a full-size graphics card stuffed in your processor.
Right, right.
But yeah, no, I know what you mean. As far as desktop computing, even in the graphics card market, I mean, they've been kind of really pushing the, can we just rebrand shit? You know what I mean? Refresh.
Drives me nuts.
Can we refresh? But you know what drives me nuts is, instead of doing this time, they really went all out on trying to drive people nuts for this last release. I mean, at least with the 200 series, it went like the 270 is now the 260. And you know what I mean? How they did it like that, like one model falls down, you know? They didn't do it for this generation.
No,
this generation,
it's same.
The 380X is a overclock 385, which actually performed a little bit worse than the 380X when it came out. Or 280X, I mean. The 280X was better than the 285. But
The Fury was the only thing we got. And that's
the
only...
390 is literally a 290.
Yeah.
Like,
same damn thing.
They didn't drop it like they're supposed to. They're supposed to make the 290 was going to be the new 380. You know what I mean? And if you are going to rebrand or refresh something, that would definitely be the best way to go about it. But they didn't do that this time at all. They literally just said, just put a new number in front of it, improve the thermals and power consumption, call it a day. But what does keep them in play with NVIDIA is their very competitive pricing.
Oh, yeah.
And their future, what's it called, DX12 performance. Mm-hmm. So
one thing, though, if they shit the bed on the 400 series and just rebrand it, If they then they're going to have a 200 that's the same as a 300, the same as a 400. If they actually, which they're not going to, but if, man, could you imagine if they did? That would
They've already done that, though. Wasn't it the 6700, the 7700s, and then it went to the 200s, then to the 300s? Aren't they all the same for the most part?
Yeah, but I think it was still one of them where it was...
It would move down a notch.
Yeah, it was moved down a notch. Yeah, no, it except was. For the 2... Yeah, the 2 to 300 wasn't even moved down.
Yeah, no, not at all.
That's annoying.
Yeah, definitely. Because then you were able to get yourself basically a 290 for a 370 price, or a 280 for a 370 price. Right. Because they didn't move it down a notch, it's not like that. You're getting a 280 for a 380 price, so... Yeah. So hopefully they do good. I'm hoping.
Well, my next article is about the 400 series, and they're going to hit that 14 nanometer architecture. So they're going to go from the 28, which they're at now, into the 14. And I think
that's another thing we didn't even talk about, the manufacturing process on these cards, man. Mm-hmm. AMD's manufacturing processes on their cards are old as shit. What is Maxwell on?
And their chips, though, their CPUs, too. Mm-hmm. Maxwell,
it's 12 now, right?
12? Might be... it's either 14 or 12.
Okay.
Let me see if I can find out.
AMD takes graphics share back from its rival. And, yeah, the DirectX 12. So I love how they were saying that these 300 series of cards you're going to want for DirectX 12. And DirectX 12 still really isn't anything. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, now they're going to be starting to brag about how you need the 400 series to take advantage of DirectX 12. It's like, I thought you said that was going to happen with the 300 series. Oh, we thought it was going to, but it didn't. So, you know, oops.
Oh, shit. Look at this. The Maxwell is manufactured in 28 nanometer. I did not realize that.
I thought they dropped it.
I thought so, too. Yeah, Maxwell is a codename for GPU microarchitecture developed by NVIDIA to succeed Kepler. Holy shit.
Is Kepler all the 700 series? Right?
Kepler was the G4, the 600 and 700, and then the 900, some of the 700 was Maxwell.
Yeah, 750 Ti, yep. 780 yep. Ti.
Mm-hmm. And then the 900 is all Maxwell.
Oh.
So they're actually not going to hit the 14 nanometer then until Pascal then, huh?
Okay.
I guess I didn't realize. I thought it was smaller than 28 nanometers.
So did I. I thought that they were like ages ahead of AMD because AMD's been refreshing their cards, the same fucking cards for the last like 8 years. So I guess maybe that's why AMD hasn't felt the need to push because NVIDIA is pushing really hard with their new stuff, but at the same time, they're not taking off on them like Intel's been taking off on AMD, you know what I mean?
Right, right.
AMD's still a very relevant competitor when it comes to graphics cards. Though, if you have $700, nothing's going to perform better than your 980 Ti.
No, that's...
But, if you don't have $700, a 380X is a really good card.
You know, I saw last week Newegg had a sale, and they had a $550 980 Ti from MSI on sale. I almost shit my pants. I almost bought it just because it was $550. I don't know what the hell I would have done with it since I already have one, but I couldn't believe it.
Mm-hmm. I'm responding to this guy. But yeah, I mean... I hope that they, so what is this? So they're just talking about the new GPUs. So what does AMD plan to do? Just in the next year, just completely smash on everybody?
You know, they've told us this before, though, when they came out with the FX series in 2011, that they were going to smash everybody to bits, and they didn't. So
in 2011, an FX series processor was actually, I'd say that's actually considered good if in 2015 it's still considered a usable CPU. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's still considered a usable CPU, but I think even in 11, they were talking that it was going to be like the shit. It was going to smoke Intel, and it didn't really smoke intel by the margin that they said it was going to. I think it was only like minuscule better at the time, and now Intel's walked away. I mean, it's well, of course Intel is more expensive, but they've walked away. If you can afford it, they've walked away.
Yeah, no, definitely. They definitely have been walking. Yeah, if you can afford an Intel, get an Intel for now. But I mean, if they're looking to just drop mega load, so are they going to have HBM on Polaris 10 and 11? Doesn't look like it. Looks like High Bandwidth 2 is not coming out till Vega.
Yep.
So what does that mean? They're just going to refresh the Fury line for the High Bandwidth, or are they not going to use the High Bandwidth for the fact that 4 gigs is not enough?
I would bet that they're going to just refresh the HBM, if I had to guess.
Mm-hmm.
But I did see, though, too, that NVIDIA, there's a rumor that they're going to use GDDR5X, which is a new GDDR5. It's supposed to clock higher and have more data throughput. So maybe that they're going to use GDDR5X as well. It's just a rumor, and I haven't seen any like official specs on GDDR5X other than it's supposedly in production, and it's going to be in the 1080 and the 1070 and the 1080 Ti from NVIDIA. That's what I understand.
Yeah,
I was looking at that today, and I thought about dropping the article for our live stream, but it was so much speculation, and I've done a lot of speculative articles lately, and I was just like, I don't want to do any more speculative articles, just because you could put anything.
Yeah.
I mean, you could say it's going to wipe your ass for you too, and it doesn't mean a damn thing. So I left that one out, but GDDR5X sounds like it's going to be the next player as well too. So I don't know how that compares to HBM, but it'll be, I guess time will tell. I guess we're looking at a June-ish at this point right now before we'll know.
You heard it. Mike said the new AMD GPU, if you buy it, it will literally grow a fist and punch an NVIDIA card. Yeah, and wipe your ass. And then it'll knock out an NVIDIA card too. So that's why we don't do too much.
But you have to make sure you buy the optional toilet paper roll. Otherwise, it's gonna just wipe your ass without toilet paper, and that could hurt.
Yeah.
So you're gonna need to buy the toilet paper add-on.
Would you rather have 4 gigs of GDDR3 or 2 gigs of GDDR5?
Two gigs GDDR5.
Well, on a graphics card, yeah.
Oh yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah, on a graphics card. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, on a graphics card, yeah. 2 gigs GDDR5 is way better for textures.
Way faster.
Yeah, it's going to be pushing faster textures a lot quicker. I forgot that they have those low-end cards with GDDR3 in them. Have you seen those?
Yep.
Okay.
In fact, it's
don't do it.
It's quite a bandwidth difference.
Yeah.
Especially the bus as well, too. The bus that DDR3 operates on and GDDR5 it would be better 2 gigs.
Yeah. 2 gigs of way faster memory. Now 2 gigs of faster memory, but you're doing way faster memory.
I'm trying to pull up something here. Let's see. So like DDR3 uses a 64-bit channel. Let's see, GDDR5 is, there's a shit ton of numbers in this article. I was hoping just for a simple explanation, but a gentleman here wrote like a book of, okay, GDDR5 can have 256 or 384 bit.
Yeah, that makes sense because that's what AMD offers on their cards.
Mm-hmm.
For the 280s, 380 something. The 290s, 380 something. Whatever you said, 386 or whatever. And then I remember NVIDIA's 770 was only at like 264 or whatever, 256.
Let's see if I can find the bandwidth difference. But I imagine the bandwidth difference just based upon the bus width would have to be substantial.
Yeah. So basically he's saying, if you see a graphics card with DDR3 in it, don't buy it because it's a ripoff. It's pointless.
Yeah, the graphics processors need so much more bandwidth. It's not a, it's not always about the RAM quantity. Now, granted, you know,
you do need RAM quantity.
You do need RAM quantity, but RAM speed, though, too, it's drastically less on 3 than it is GDDR5.
Yep. So, do you want to get started with this Doom one real quick for me?
Yeah. Sure. I would love to. This one kills me because I grew up in when Doom wasn't out yet, and I started with Wolfenstein. So Doom to me was huge, and I had like a 486 or a 486 SX25 at the time with 2 megabytes of RAM, and I wanted to play friggin' Doom. You know what I mean? And it was so funny because the sheer size of the game was like, oh my god, it's unbelievable how big this game is, and now a web page is bigger than the game that I like had to play when I was growing up. I had to play it. I remember I had to buy more RAM. I bought a 4 megabyte stick of RAM for like $300 for 4 megabytes because 2 wasn't enough. So I needed to either buy another 2 or a 4. So I ended up buying the 4 because per megabyte 4 was cheaper than 2 at the time.
Well, $300 kind of seems like ridiculous. Jesus.
Oh, yeah. Just so I could play Doom. And now a freaking web page is larger than that game that I was just like, I like lost so much sleep because I couldn't play it. I have to have it. So I spent $300 on a RAM upgrade.
That's kind of ridiculous system requirements that they would require. Like nowadays it's like, oh yeah, 6 gigs of RAM, which if you break it down, that's what, $15 for every 4 gigs,
yeah.
$7 for every 2 gigs. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, it's like $20 worth of RAM and to play it, to make the requirements for a game, as to where this one was like, you need $300 worth of RAM.
I know,
if
right?
If you want to play this game, which probably did not look too good, I take it. No, the graphics were probably...
I mean, for the time, it was... When you go from Wolfenstein to Doom, it was...
It was groundbreaking.
and the lighting and the music and the mood.
Well, it was like it was like when you were playing fucking old school Nintendos and then PlayStation came out.
Yeah.
And the graphics were just like... I remember Final Fantasy VIII. The graphics on Final Fantasy VIII.
Yeah.
That was like groundbreaking for its time. We were just like, oh my god, you can barely tell they're polygons. And like, mm-hmm, it's like they look so three-dimensional. And you know, this was back, you know, when 3D was becoming more and more. Devil May Cry for PlayStation 2.
Oh, yeah.
When that game came out, that looked really nice once again. Even PS2 games. Now it's like, I go and play my Xbox 360 and I'm like, damn, these graphics suck.
I know, right?
30 FPS is killing me. 720p looks like shit, and the game textures are terrible. So it's you know, that was what was it? 360 is pretty old now. What, 11 years old?
Years old? Just in fact, it just had its 10th birthday, I think, because they just recently announced that they're discontinuing production of the 360.
Yeah. So that just shows you right there. Yeah.
How old were you in 1993? When were you born?
1990, so I was 3 years old.
Oh my god, so yeah, you didn't get the Doom. You were too young for the Doom hype. I was 14, so yeah, for me, the Doom hype was huge.
I believe it.
It was big deal.
Was it multiplayer? Was there internet back then?
No. Yeah, there was AOL, and it was dial-up, and it was like a 2400 BPS.
It was like internet, like the singular term. There was internet, not internets.
Yeah, yeah. And it was entirely text-based, except for AOL. AOL had some graphical things to it, but yeah, there was really not the multiplayer like we have today where you just like jump online and go. It was a much more complicating process back then with baud rates and modems and then you're taking up the telephone line when your parents want to use the phone. But
I do remember that.
Yeah. Oh, you do? Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Well, I got my first computer that I got to play around with was in like 2000. So obviously it was, you know, the AOL was still big. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like you would always get those little discs and cards that you would get the free month trial with to get some dial up. You'd have to sit there and it sounded like a damn fax machine while you're logging in. And everyone used AOL Instant Messenger and shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
Or AIM is what they called it.
AIM, yep.
Yeah.
Yep, I remember when I first was getting on the internet, you used to have to pay by the minute to be...
Really?
to be connected. Yeah.
Wow.
It was, yeah, you bought hours is what you bought when your subscription. So you'd pay $20 a month to be able to sign on to AOL, and you would get a certain amount of time. I can't remember. But then if you went over that time, which, as you can imagine, with the slow download rates, it isn't hard to do.
Yeah.
Then you had to start paying a fee in order to be on the service. It was a strange time, but it led to where we are today. I couldn't go back to dial up. I know that for sure.
Oh, hell no.
Crazy.
God, no. But I wasn't a heavy computer user. So mm-hmm. like it came out a lot to me when I noticed, because if you're a heavy computer user, you just start seeing more and more colorful ads, pictures, and textures on your screen when you're going to these websites. If you were like me, where I would touch a computer once every year or two, it went from a web page being completely text-based and maybe one or two thumbnails to literally just being littered with color and thumbnails, like out of nowhere, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's like the only place you could have found that much color on a web page was when Facebook, like, had fully gotten developed. Once Facebook had fully been added out and there was all this cool stuff and you could change your profile and picture and background and all that stuff. Which was a hassle. You had to do it with the coding. You'd have to copy the HTML codes or whatever, paste it in your Facebook to change your background and stuff for the templates. So mm-hmm. it went, yeah, that's what I said. Like, it went from like these plain looking web pages that just had text in different sizes to straight up being like, everything's a freaking link. Everything's an ad. There's moving pictures. There's like five different people talking at the same time, trying to get you to buy toothpaste or whatever. Yeah, it was a big change. And like I said, because I didn't regularly use a computer, it didn't happen slow for me. Or, you know what I mean? It wasn't right, something that I was like, oh, now they added another ad page here. Oh, there's another one here now. You know, 2 years later, there's another one. It just randomly went from nothing to just a shit ton of stuff everywhere. And it's like, oh my God, the internet's so colorful now. I remember when it wasn't. I remember trying to use the internet on a cell phone. You remember when cell phones first got internet?
Yeah, yeah.
Say it looked just like what the computers did at first. It was just like all text and like a couple of links that you could click on the page. And it was really hard to navigate the websites because there was no such thing as a touchscreen back then. You just had the four little arrows. So, yeah, good old days.
My first time online, I logged on at 2,400 bits per second. So 300 bytes per second was the up and down transfer rate, and you could only do one way. It mm-hmm. was it wasn't a two way stream, so you could transfer up and then you could transfer down, but you couldn't do them both at the same time.
Yeah.
So literally slow as F, 300 bytes per second. I mean, even downloading Doom, it says here, was 2,250 kilobytes. It would take you days.
Yeah, you know, and right now we're uploading a stream at 3,600 kilobits a second.
Oh yeah, steady. So we're doing more than Doom every second.
Yep, we could download Doom in an hour. Was that 60 times 60? Yeah, that's how many times we could have downloaded Doom in an hour.
Yeah. I don't know. Have you ever played the original Doom?
So what are they doing? Are they revising it? Right?
Yeah,
is that what they're doing?
Yeah, there's a new Doom coming out in May.
Mm-hmm.
That's you know, bringing it back to life, I guess, is what you could say. I mean, we haven't had a Doom in a while since Doom 3, but so this is the Doom 4.
Played Doom 3, but I had a lot of people on Xbox that were going nuts over it.
Mm-hmm. It was all right.
Was that like more of like a multiplayer campaign type game or no?
To my knowledge, I don't think it was multiplayer intensive. I think it was more single player intensive, campaign intensive. Yeah, okay. It's not like Call of Duty now where you have a 5-hour campaign but you have a million hours online. The Doom 3, it was more like it was probably a 20 to 40 hour game, depending on how much shit you did or how many times you died. And it was more of a story driven thing, and I don't think it had the multiplayer aspects.
Okay.
But it might, but I never used multiplayer.
So is this them revising the first Doom, or just they're going to be releasing like a Doom 4?
Yeah, is going to be like, from what I understand, it's like a Doom 4.
Okay, and they're saying here things like, ultra-wide monitor support, uncapped frame rates, and a bunch of advanced settings that basically we've all come to see as a standard for any PC game.
Yeah, unless it's a port, you know what I mean? Sometimes we get those console ports.
Dead Rising 3.
There you Perfect go. Example. Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Dark Souls 3.
So this is going to be a multi-console and PC release, but the PC is going to get their full range of options, which I think is
what they should do every single time they release a game, whether it's console-bound or not. They should do that every time.
Especially since we're paying the same price. So what the fuck? It's like, do the due diligence and give us our options.
Well, have you seen Dark Souls 3? Have you played it?
It's one of my things coming up about it. But we're buying these multi-$1,000 PCs. We want these details. We want these levels of adjustments.
Just fucking playable.
We want it. Playable. We want it to work.
Exactly. Yeah. Like Dead Rising 3. It runs, but that game caps itself at 30 FPS.
Mm.
Why? Okay, so you can.
You're kidding me. 30?
But you can uncap it, but the game can still run shitty as fuck. So like even with a 980 Ti, max settings will get me like 70 frames per second with dips to 40. You know what I mean? So it's just terrible porting. Okay, Dark Souls 3 is another one. My brother has it. Mm-hmm. This has been plaguing it with Dark Souls 3. Hopefully this isn't what your topic's about. Let me check. It is. Performance.
Well, a little bit. This is more a win for AMD on that. But we can... Yeah, it doesn't... Yeah, you can continue on when you talk about it. It isn't going
to
spoil it.
There is a problem with Dark Souls 3 that comes to where the game will straight up just crash. Just completely crash. And it's caused from the detail settings. Like, my brother's got a 4790K and a GTX 770, and he has to drop all settings to low so the game doesn't crash. You know what I mean? I've tweaked it out and figured out I have a few settings that had to be set to low, the ones that were making it crash. They supposedly had released a patch, but I haven't heard back from him if it worked yet or not. But and this is like something that's been plaguing all the users. Basically, one of the main culprits is the light settings. You have to lower your light settings to low, the shadow settings and light settings. Otherwise, the game will just crash.
Terrible.
And it was like that for its first week of release. Like, they didn't release the update till, like, 4 days ago, 5 days ago. The game's been out for, like, over a week, you know, 2 weeks. So, I agree with you with that. The fact that Doom is making this, some people may be like, oh, well, having that full range of settings, every PC game has that. Yes, but there's a lot of PC console games that do not at all. Like, you can't turn VSync off in Dark Souls 3.
Ugh.
It's capped at 60. There is no way to do it. From what I've been reading up so far, no one's really found a way. Like I said, with Dead Rising 3, by changing one of the .ini files, you can get rid of VSync. But from what people have been saying, they haven't found a way to do it with Dark Souls yet. So it's like, why are you capping a PC game at 60 FPS? I don't get it. You know what I mean? So either way, there's that.
I have a 144 hertz monitor, and
it still caps it at 60.
Yeah. I want to use it. You know, exactly. I have a 980 Ti, and I want to use my...
You literally have $1,400 worth of, like, graphical displaying equipment, and you can't use it.
Not on some games. On some, you can. Like Metal Gear Solid 5 was a great example. 60 Grand frames, Theft Auto. That's it. Grand Theft Auto.
That game will let you uncap frame. That game has so many settings you can tweak in there.
That was a great port. That's a perfect PC
Perfect PC console port. Like, they did great on Grand Theft Auto 5. And that's because Grand Theft Auto 4 sucked ass as far as porting went.
Mm, yeah.
And Dead Rising's always had this problem with porting. As far as I remember, all the Dead Risings that came out for PC never really ran too great. There was always some issues with them.
That's not right, because they know they're releasing it on PC. So put some effort into it if you're going to charge...
The same amount.
Give us what we paid for.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So next you have Fallout 4.
You like
Fallout 4, so go ahead.
You know, I finally finished it, and it was underwhelming. The last 25% of the game was
That's not what you want to hear.
but the first 75 I thought was great. But anyway, so here's me. I like Skyrim. I beat the game, and then I went to the mods, man. I went to the mods and added the quests and added all that stuff. So, and I'm not a big achievements person, but mods are something that I feel like we should be allowed to do. You know what I mean? But now they're going to punish people by not allowing them achievements. Now, maybe they're going to do it in such a certain way that it's only certain achievements that certain mods break the way you get to that achievement. I'm not exactly sure, but hopefully they don't go crazy and then just, you know, start punishing us now for modding a game.
Yeah, especially when these games, they get a lot of, like you said, players that want the mods. It's not, it's like 50% you buy the game because it's Fallout. The other 50% you know is because the mods are going to be great. Same with Skyrim. You think all these people dump thousands of hours into Skyrim because they like Skyrim? No, it's because they like the mods that Skyrim comes with. So the game developers should embrace that fact. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, why not take that extra? It's like you're getting, this guy wanted 50% of your game, the other 50% he wanted mods, but it still incorporates your game. Take that 100% and be happy. You know what I mean? But
so hopefully it doesn't go any further than this about disabling achievements. I don't give a shit about achievements, honestly, but some people do.
Yeah.
And I hope this doesn't go further than just the achievement.
Yeah, hopefully not. Hopefully. So we'll go to the Dark Souls one. I want to see what you had here. So what is this?
This one here, I was really curious. AMD holds their own pretty well with Dark Souls without the DirectX 12. So I think if Dark Souls becomes a DirectX 12 title,
It's not.
It's only 11, but they could release, knock on wood, they could release a patch in order to make it DirectX 12.
To enable DirectX 12 features. Yeah.
But AMD holds its own pretty well for the price. If you look at price comparison further down in 1440p and 4K, they do very well. And I'm actually surprised because especially on a newer release of a game, sometimes AMD sucks ass for weeks.
Yeah,
you know, until they get the driver. Yeah.
Yeah.
But this one here has not been out that long.
Wow. The 390 is keeping up with the 980.
Yeah. That's pretty good considering it just came out because AMD's always way behind.
Wow. Well, okay.
They're always behind on their drivers.
Since the viewers can't see the numbers, we'll go ahead and read them.
You're right.
Fury
yeah.
X is at, what is that? Average FPS of 59.6. The 980 Ti is at an average of 59.9. So literally, the 980 Ti is edging it out by 0.3.
At 1440p.
This is 1440, yes.
This is 1440, and I'm assuming that it's just maxed. All the detail settings must be maxed.
Yeah, probably. More than likely.
So AMD is doing really good with their drivers here, because usually you would see that would be a much larger win for AMD.
Well, the drops are for the Fury X is 45, and the drops for the 980 Ti is 58. So it literally held its and the reason you're not going to see these go higher than 59 is because they're capped at 60.
60. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, I guess we should point that out. Yeah.
But I will say for the 4K, you can definitely see where the Fury X runs into not having enough memory.
Mm-hmm.
36.9 versus 980 Ti with its 6 gigs at 43.3. So at 4K, obviously the 980 Ti is going to beat it because 4 gigs of memory is just not enough regardless of how fast it is. And AMD learned that the hard way.
Yeah.
So that's really good performance. My brother has a GTX 770, which will pretty much line up a little bit with the 960.
But does he like it?
What, the game?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, he loves it. He says he's a huge Dark Souls 1 fan and Dark Souls snob, more or less. So like when Dark Souls 2 came out, I mean, he liked it because it was Dark Souls, but at the same time, it was made with a different creator, so it didn't have the same Dark Souls feel. He said the new Dark Souls definitely has that, and they took the good things from the second game that they did like and left the things that they didn't like, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because the second game, I guess, conflicted with a lot of the lore that is Dark Souls. So I don't really know much about it, but he did tell me one thing he is upset about, the lack of new weapons. Hopefully they'll release some updates and patches with newer stuff, but he's saying basically, they just reused all the weapons from the first and the second one. They didn't really include too much more as far as new things. And I thought of it a really good way to fix that, which would have been just reskin the weapons, rename them reskin them, let them have the same stats, and just rename and reskin them so it feels like you're using a different weapon.
It feels new. Yeah.
And even if it has the same stats and someone figures out, well, this has the same stats, that's lazy. Well, it's better than just putting the same damn weapon. You know what I mean? Reskin it so it at least looks different. And he said if that had happened, he would have been happy with that just because it would have been a different feel. You know,
it looks pretty.
Yeah, it looks new. The game. The game looks pretty. Definitely way better. He also played Dark Souls 1 and 2. He beat several times over originally on the 360. So when he played Dark Souls 1 and 2 on PC, he said it looked 100 times better and way less laggy. The fact that 30 FPS versus 60 FPS was, you know, just a huge difference, double the frame rate. Dark Souls 3 is the same way. When he's playing on the PC, it still looks really smooth, looks really nice. But I will say this, his GTX 770 dips frames on high settings, yeah. And I mean, I feel like a 770 should be able to max out a console game, which is just probably something to do with porting. They didn't properly optimize the game like they never do, you know?
Right.
So, because I mean, it's a console game. If an Xbox can play it on its APU, I feel like a full-size GTX 770 should be able to max the thing out no problem.
Yeah, without even breaking a sweat.
Yep. And I mean, where's the minimum specs here? An A8 3870, so basically a decent quad-core CPU.
Mm-hmm.
Core i3-2100, basically quad-thread. And a GTX 465, oh my god. Oh.
That's going way back.
And that's what I'm saying. And the fact that a GTX 770 won't max the game out, but your minimum requirements is a 465, you know what
I mean? Look at the recommended, it's only a 750. So a 770 recommended should be good settings. So 770 would blow a 750. It's not even a 750 Ti, it's just a plain 750.
Yeah, so a 770 should just eat that thing in pieces, but no. That game fully maxed out. I mean, it'll hold at 60 FPS. But when he gets around graphically intensive parts, it'll dip to like 30 or 40. And you can see that because he's got, you know, it's VSync on for that
game. It's all in the coding. Yeah. All in the coding. It's nothing to do with the performance. It's just piss poor coding.
Yeah. Bad porting.
That's too bad.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, if you get powerful enough stuff, I'm pretty sure you can run it without those dips. But he's running into those dips because this guy said, "Sir, dude. Sup, homie." Okay, but so he's running into these dips, and it kind of sucks, and I understand it is around graphically intensive parts. I just wish you could turn VSync off so those dips wouldn't be as noticeable, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The dips are super noticeable because you have VSync, so it starts fucking lagging and skipping and shit. What car do I drive? I don't drive a fast car. What about you, Mike?
I drive a Toyota Tundra. It's fairly fast, but it's...
this is a V8 Tundra, right?
Yeah, I got the biggest engine you can get, so it's got...
5.7?
5.7.
Okay.
Just under 400 horsepower. I wouldn't say it's... it's just got a lot of power. It tows well, but I don't know if I would say it's like...
Lots fast. Of low-end torque. That's what you got.
Oh, yeah. Like, off the line, that thing is nuts. I beat Mustang GTs off the line.
Yeah?
Yeah, because that thing right off the line, it grunts. If I can keep the wheels from spinning. If the wheels spin in the truck, because it will too, it'll just light them up. But low-end off the line, that thing is, man, it just jumps. But then the Mustang will start to take away after about 20 miles an hour or so.
I drive a 98 Dodge Dakota, sadly. V6.
I have an 88. I have an 88 Dodge Dakota as a second vehicle. Yeah, so I mean, I like it. Yeah, it's a nice truck to beat around in.
Yeah, I've already told Mike several times it makes me sad. In my driveway, I have a 97 V8 Dakota 5.2 liter Magnum engine, and I love that thing. And it's four-wheel drive, but, yeah, it runs like shit, and I haven't put time into making it run right. So, currently, I'm driving a 98 V6 two-wheel drive. I just hate the two-wheel drive part. That's like a kick in the balls. But my daily driver's a sport bike, so I've put 100 miles on my truck, almost 100 miles in the last month and a half. Meanwhile, I put about 300 to 400 miles on my bike a week. So, yeah, it's just because I don't enjoy driving cars. I enjoy riding my bike. All right, last topic, Amazon.
One thing real quick.
Go ahead.
I finally found the bandwidth difference between DDR3 and GDDR5.
All right, what is that?
So, for example, there's two cards here. One's a 2 gigabyte GDDR3, and one's a 1 gigabyte GDDR5. The GDDR3...
Is that like the 240 or something, 250?
It is.
I know they make a 3 gig version of like the 240 or 250.
It's a 7700. So I
HD
don't...
7700?
Yeah, yeah. So it's definitely a lower end older card.
Yeah. Okay.
And it does 25 gigabytes a second.
Ew.
And the GDDR5 does 307 gigabytes per second.
So there's a difference.
There's quite a difference there.
That's the difference between transferring...
12 times.
Yeah, that's the difference between transferring basically what? Did you say megabits a second, right?
25 gigabits to gigabits. 300
gigabits. Okay, so it's a gigabit. Well, it's the difference between transferring like basically a song in 1 second, you know, or transferring a full audio in like a fraction of a second. So that just give you when you're moving around textures, details, and all those graphics card stuff. Yeah, that guy left, but yeah, that's what 300 versus 25 is what you said, right?
Yeah, it's
like 12 times faster.
It's substantial.
Yeah,
it's substantial for
that's,
sure.
That's definitely and like 12 times faster.
In the Heaven benchmark, it's the difference between 20 frames and 29 frames. So it's quite a difference. 9 more frames on 30 is that's
probably using extremely low textures. You up the texture detail. That's the only reason the settings are probably like that is because the DDR3 can't handle anything higher than super low. Yeah. So.
And it's 720p as well too. So I mean, imagine when you start to hit 1080p, that DDR3 is gonna just really take a dump.
Yep. Alrighty. So your last one, Amazon restricts sales of popular movies and games. What does that mean?
What do you think? So certain movies and games on Amazon, you can only buy if you're a Prime member.
Couldn't you just buy it somewhere else then?
Yeah. You could. Yeah, but but it's just interesting though that they would even attempt this. I could see maybe giving a discount, like maybe it's $2 cheaper if you're a Prime member. You know, so it's $59.99 if you're not Prime, and it's $57.99 if you are.
Yeah.
For a game or whatever for a movie, a dollar cheaper for a movie, but. I was actually surprised to see this thing that they are looking at or maybe even doing. If you're not a Prime member, you can't buy the damn thing. I've seen to where, like, if you're a Prime member,
you go to eBay.
You can reserve it.
Go to BestBuy.com.
Yeah, it's just crazy.
Like, if it's, where's this? Games like Far Cry Primal, buy it off Steam.
Yeah.
You don't have to pay for a Steam membership. It's free.
I haven't bought a game on Amazon in years anyway, but it's just funny that with the decline...
Oh, Battlefield Hardline. Yeah. Buy it on Origin.
Yeah, buy it on Origin. Yeah.
That's so stupid.
Who buys games on Amazon anyway?
Yeah.
That's the first question. But movies, I mean, some people do buy movies on Amazon if you want the physical copy.
eBay.
eBay.
Best Buy.
Why? It's just funny. Why are they restricting some of those purchases to Prime?
That's got to be the dumbest thing ever, because any non-Prime member, they're just going to automatically lose that sale. Because you do have diehard Amazon members that aren't Prime members.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know several of my roommates like that. I always order off of whatever I can find as far as websites I like and stuff like that. And I'll also order from eBay a lot of times, you know, over those other websites. But I'll order from Amazon if I have to, but my roommate is the complete opposite. He only goes through Amazon. He's not even a Prime member. He just uses Amazon. So whenever he looks to buy something, he goes through Amazon. Whenever I look to go buy something, I go all over the place. Doesn't matter. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I use Amazon Prime because of their shipping. Just because to ship to me in Montana, sometimes it's fairly high. Yeah, it's fairly high. So I can get their 2-day shipping for really reasonable. Like, I mean,
why don't you do like the Newegg Pro member thing? You
were I do that as well.
How much does that cost?
I think it's $50 a year.
Really? That's it?
And I make out way ahead because it used to cost me, it was $10 every time I ordered something from Newegg.
Yeah.
And I order shit from Newegg every week. So I make out way ahead. And I get it faster being the Newegg Premier member. And same with Amazon Prime. I get it faster and significantly cheaper. So I make out way ahead by being subscribed to both of those. But maybe in some other areas like LA or something, maybe you don't make out ahead. But shipping to Montana sometimes is a little more expensive.
Well, see, I live in Vegas, and they have a Newegg hub right outside of Vegas. So, like, it literally, dude, as long as – I will say this. A lot of times when I buy refurbished stuff, it comes from the other side of the U.S., and they always ship it fucking FedEx. And FedEx always takes forever.
FedEx is slow for me too.
But like when they ship me stuff from their hub, like in California, I usually get that in 2 days, sometimes 24 hours.
Oh wow!
Yeah, they just literally just the Newegg truck just drives it to my house.
Perfect.
So, yeah, exactly. So I do like that. But I have been thinking about it because like I haven't been ordering off Newegg a lot lately. But when I was heavily ordering off Newegg, like. My Newegg purchase history is ridiculous. It's like 10 computers in the last couple months. And, it would be nice to not have to wait a week for some of the parts. You know what I mean?
Because
sometimes a part will come from across the country, and it'll take over a week to get to me, you know? And you never know until after you buy it.
Yeah, like, yeah, exactly. Yeah,
you won't know until you get your tracking number. So, yeah, but I can't believe they do that. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I mean, go to GameStop. If you need to buy a game, then screw it. Don't boycott Amazon from now on, you guys.
I really wish that they would have just given like a $2 discount or a dollar discount rather than...
This is a dumb power move by a company that's like, we make enough money. Let's fucking do it. Who cares? Yep. What is someone going to say to us?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, you don't want to buy it? Well, guess what? This fucking 500,000 people over here don't mind doing it, so bye.
Right even down the lower down, it says, at the moment, this shouldn't affect PC gamers.
Does it?
Yeah. After all, many PC gamers how many PC gamers are buying physical copies? And that's very true.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember the last time I bought a physical copy other than like a limited edition that came with like a statue of something that I really wanted. Like the Skyrim dragon, I'm talking about the $200 or whatever it was to get that statue.
I have these. I bought them at Walmart because I saw them.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Lego Master Chief on a little Lego. Universe. Oh, hold on. I'll show you one better. This one's fucking sweet. It's a Lego Banshee.
I have to wait. I'll have to wait to see it on the stream. But,
oh, yeah. You'll have to see it. And then I'll got
30 seconds.
I have a couple of them. And then I have the Lego fucking Elite with his sword. It's a sweet Lego set. So I bought that. That's as far as action figures go for me.
You're a big Halo fan, right?
Yeah. Yeah, sadly, I haven't played. I actually have not played Halo 5, which makes me sound like a horrible Halo fan. But if you guys don't believe me, on Halo 3, I was ranked at like a 37 in SWAT and Team Slayer, and in Halo Reach, I don't remember. I was almost at like the last four of the tiers, like when you level yourself up. I know it was past Brigadier, like pretty far past that. I think it was a past general too, as well. I just don't remember which one I was at, but I was edging up on the line where you get to like mythic and forerunner and stuff like that. You get to those ones, inheritor and shit. So I was almost to those on Halo Reach, and before Halo 4 came out, I was doing I would play a lot of Big Team Slayer. I was getting like 70 kills a game, 60 kills a game. Yeah, I played a lot of Halo Reach, and then Halo 4, I played it for about 3 or 4 months, got to a pretty high level, was doing like 20 to 30 kills in the Team Slayer match a game, and then stopped playing it because I just got bored of it. I still turn it on every now and then, and I'll get about 20, 30 kills a game still because I played that much Halo to where it just kind of stays with me.
Muscle memory.
Yeah, exactly. Just too much Halo over the years. But I have not played Halo 5, and the reason why is because it got rid of the Xbox One because It was basically a $500 Roku box that no one used. You know what I mean? We had computers. But and this was, we sold it before Halo 5 came out. Trust me, I wouldn't have sold it if Halo 5 was, you know, right there. You know, but we sold it a while before Halo 5 came out. You still have Xbox One? Nope.
Nope.
You don't have one?
Nope. Do you have or PS4? No.
No consoles?
No. I have a PS3 and everything from PS3 down, pretty much, yeah, all the way to Atari 2600. But I don't have anything above that. Well, I was kind of upset with the whole recent news that there's the PS 4.5, basically, and Xbox One talking. And it's like, at that point, it's a damn computer. They're upgrading them now.
Yeah.
It's like, shit, that's what I do to my computer. I upgrade it every year. Now they're going to talk about upgrading consoles every 2 or 3 years. It's like not even a console anymore then.
So basically, you're going to be paying for two things, the software and the case. That's basically all you're going to keep the same. The software and the case. You're literally going to buy your first console, and every 2 years, you're going to upgrade the motherboard and the CPU, integrated CPU with the RAM, and they'll probably do it as a full package, you mm-hmm. know, set power supply for it. And that's also going to suck because warranties for them are, they have to look at it like this. Dude, how many people's warranties are going to get broken for this? Mm-hmm. Like, oh, yeah, you know, this isn't covered under your warranty. It's not like how it was in the past when you're like, dude, my fucking Xbox just won't work anymore. They'd be like, oh, well, which part of your Xbox doesn't work? Because we'll only warranty the part that's broken.
Yep.
You know what I mean? So it's not going to be like where you had a broken Xbox and you send it in and get a different one, you know.
Might as well just buy a PC now.
Yep. Boycott Xboxes so that way they just move to console and Halo's forced to be put on PC.
Oh, man. I would love that because I want to actually play the Halo series, but I'm so shitty at a controller. I need the mouse and keyboard.
Well, I told you, man, if you want, download. I haven't sent you the link, have I? I'm going to do that. You go to download Halo online. I'll send you a link. I can actually just put it in the Dropbox, can't I?
Yeah, put it in the Dropbox.
That way you don't even have to download it.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, yeah, you got the fast internet connection. You can probably drop it in my Dropbox.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll do that.
Yeah. And with my shitty upload, if I send something to you, it'd take a year.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You just download it from the Dropbox, huh?
Yeah.
You don't have to upload it?
Nope.
Oh, shit. I don't even notice when I put movies or the videos into your Dropbox. I don't even notice. It just instantly happens.
It's just done.
Yeah. Right? Well, also, when you download the MP4 from YouTube, it's also really small. Like very.
Oh, that's true too.
They nicely compress it for you. So.
Yeah, it is pretty small MP4.
But yeah, it's already 7:30. We've been going for well over an hour. We can call it a day. I got my clean laundry out of my dryer and I just threw it on my floor to start the stream because I was in a hurry. So I'm gonna fold my laundry and go back.
Hey man, life happens, you know.
Yeah, I'm gonna probably play some Left 4 Dead while the rest of my laundry finishes and then throw it all on the floor as a pile and fold it.
Have you that new Tomb Raider is good too. If you
played it finally?
Yeah, I started because since I finished Fallout 4, I started the new Tomb Raider, and I actually enjoy it. It's beautiful.
Yeah, no, it's a good looking game, huh? How's it run on the 90 Ti?
I do have some dips under 60, but with a G-Sync monitor, you don't notice it as much. Yeah.
Even what are you at 1080p?
1440.
Okay, you're at 1440. At
yeah,
least.
So I set.
You have a 1440 144.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
With G-Sync.
I wish I had that.
It was $600. It was expensive, unfortunately. But that game is beautiful if you ever get a chance to play.
I was so mad. You can get mad with me. On Newegg, I got an email for a sale. 144 Hz monitor for $320, 1440p. Here goes the kicker. FreeSync.
Oh,
I know. I was like, God damn it. I have a 980 Ti. I was like, I want that 144. $320, man. If I would have bought a freaking Fury X, I could have had a 1440p 144 FreeSync monitor. God damn it.
The problem that people don't understand is if you buy a 144 Hz monitor and you want to use it at 144 Hz, if you don't have G-Sync or FreeSync or the capable hardware, you're going to notice a shit ton of micro stuttering because you're never going to hit 144 or if you do, you don't hit it enough.
Well, you just never play with V-Sync on.
Or you never play with V-Sync on.
Yeah,
right.
So, and like, for instance, in Grand Theft Auto, 1440p, I'll hover around 80 to 90 FPS.
Mm-hmm.
Just no V-Sync. That works
fine. Just no V-Sync.
Yeah.
That part works okay.
Because it never goes over 144. And those demanding games, you'll never get over 144. You know what I mean?
No, I can. The most I've ever seen Tomb Raider get at max settings, I've seen it at a little over 100, and I've seen it as low as 40, but I've never seen it above. I've never seen 144.
Yeah, exactly.
And I probably won't with a single 980 Ti.
Yeah.
There's so many settings, and it's. I mean, when you turn that motherfucker up, it is beautiful. It's a good looking game. Yeah, and so far, the story. I like the story so far too. So because it's not all about graphics, you got to have good play too. So
my girlfriend's been having fun on that. She's only got a 980, but here goes the fun part about that. She has an FX 8320. And she plays that game on pretty high settings. Mm-hmm. No problem.
Oh, yeah.
So that just shows you guys the FX is still there.
It's a good port, too.
It is.
It's a good console port. It's not shittily done. They did their job.
Yeah, she's going to get my i7 whenever I upgrade. When I go up to the 5820K or the new Broadwell one, I'll give her my i7 and my RAM and stuff so she can...
I'm still kicking it around. I might end up doing something stupid like buying a Broadwell E, but... We'll see.
Did you ever find out what a more reasonable release date on that is, when it's actually going to come?
Nothing. I looked this. Everything was still speculation, so I didn't want to get into. And the speculation was still the same, so it wasn't like anything was going to change.
Unreleased Gigabyte motherboards for. Oh, so they're going to release new motherboards for the Broadwell E, though? When Broadwell E comes out, they're going to come out with new.
Yes.
I would hope 2011-3 socket motherboards.
Yeah, and yeah, it'll work with the old ones, but they're also going to have new 2011-3, yes. Okay. New boards, or new revisions,
When's Computex? June?
Oh, it's June something.
Computex will take place May 31st to June 4th in Taipei. Broadwell E is based on... So they're going to have a more look at a concrete date at Computex, is what they're saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, so is that... Is Computex, do they normally release on Computex or just talk about it and release it 10 years later?
Talk about it. And then, release it, yeah. If I had to guess, I was at the Haswell E release at PAX in 2014.
Uh-huh.
And they actually released it at PAX. So I wonder if they wouldn't do that at PAX Prime, which is the Seattle one. And it's always in like September-ish. So I wonder if they're not going to talk about it at Computex and then release it at PAX. That's what I think will happen, just based upon Haswell E's release at PAX in 2014. I think that we might see it. That's just my guess.
Mm-hmm. Okay. 8 cores, 16 threads, man.
Mm-hmm. And even the Xeons get up to 22 cores, which I think is just unbelievable.
Oh, here we go. They're going to have the 6900K, which is going to replace the 5930K. Mm-hmm. 8 cores, 16 threads, 140 watt TDP. That seems a bit high, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't seem like they lowered it at all.
No, I think it's actually up. I think the...
It's
the,
125, the, right?
I think it's 130. My Ivy Bridge E is 130.
Yeah,
and I think the Haswell E is still 130.
How did they shrink the die and then go up in
more transistors is the only thing I can think of.
Yeah. Well, base clock of 3.2, turbo 3.7. The next is going to be the 6850K, which is probably what I'll be looking at, and mm-hmm. maybe you.
Probably me, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Jerry, would you be willing to jump another $500 on a CPU, or you gonna go for the cheaper route?
Yeah, not after the difference the last time. It's not enough of a difference for the money.
Yeah. But I will say the 5820K is something nice to have as far as the editing goes and the gaming. Mm-hmm. Like, because on top, and this is why I think that the 5820K to me is better than getting something like a 5960X, is because unless you really need those extra cores, which 99% of the people that use a computer for gaming will not need. You know what I mean? Even as us as content creators, we don't need that. You know what I mean? We can get away with the 5820K. And it also handles gaming just as well, you know. So I'll probably go for the 6850K, which is going to be 6 cores, 12 threads, 140 watt TDP as well, 3.6 gigahertz, turbo up to 3.8, cache size 15 megabytes. It's 2.5 megs per core.
Mm-hmm.
And 2133 megahertz and 2400 megahertz. So, doesn't seem like they're going to be supporting that quick of memory, huh?
No, no. It's not. It's kind of... Because that's the starting. That, it doesn't that might start be at 21?
Yeah, 2133 is the bottom of DDR4.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And 2400 is only one step up.
Yeah.
So, I feel like that has to do a lot with it just being on an X99 board.
It could
not,
be.
Not making a new board for it and not making the new processor for a new board.
Right, right.
Yeah. So, and then the 6800K, which will be the... it's going to be, I guess, considered a new addition to the family. I guess they're not doing a 5960X style one. Because they had the 6800K, the 6900K, and the 6850K.
Okay,
maybe the 6850K is the 6800K. It's gonna be, they're both going to be six cores.
Mm-hmm. They're both six cores, right.
So maybe they'll release a 6960, you know what I mean, after they release these. So apparently they're going to be introducing a new addition to this, which is going to be the 6800K, which is going to be one step under the 6850. So imagine a 5800K instead of the...
Right, just a little slower, slower clock.
So what this one is going to be... aims to be a hex core in the hands of the average PC user.
Mm-hmm.
Probably be less than the $450 mark. I would hope so, because you can get a 5820K for about $370. $320 if you get it at Fry's on sale.
Yeah, yeah, it's an inexpensive processor.
Mm-hmm. And this is 3.4 to 3.6 at 15 megabytes, 2 megabytes per core.
I do see a rumored article, though, about a 6950X that's a 10-core, 20-thread CPU.
Okay. So from the projected rates, it's still to be decided, but it's saying $450 for the lowest tier.
Yep.
That's kind of higher price than what the 5820K was. That's not really fair. You know what I mean?
No, it is a lot higher. So hopefully that's wrong.
And doesn't the 5820K have 15 megs of L3 cache as well?
Yes.
And it's on the X99 platform as well? And supports and DDR4 memory?
And it's 6 cores, 12 threads. It's almost the same thing.
Except for the processing node.
14 nanometers. That's so, the only... Maybe it's a shit ton faster. It's going to have to be a shit ton faster in order to make it worthwhile. But I doubt it's going to be much more instructions per clock.
I will say this, though. The reason that when you said it was on a new nanometer, the reason I said I might just wait for Broadwell then is because when I used a Haswell Pentium G and played Grand Theft Auto V, it stuttered. When I used a Skylake Pentium G, didn't stutter at all.
Oh.
So obviously... something changed in that 14 nanometer from going from the, what is it on the Haswells, 20 something? I don't remember. I don't 20, 24. I don't know. 22. I don't know.
I can't. Really. Yeah. It's escaping me at the moment.
Yeah. Right. And it's like, this is something that I should know either or as well. So either way, the reason that is because obviously something improved between those two. So it's a 22 nanometer.
22, okay. Okay,
and then it dropped to the 14 nanometer Skylake. Skylake's 14, right?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay, so something in between there, because a lot of, on paper, it doesn't look like a lot's changed from the Pentium G4400 and the Pentium G3250, 3258, 3240, or whatever, 3440, or whatever the hell they want to call it. I don't remember. But for some reason, it doesn't stutter in GTA and ran a couple of other games smoother. Mm-hmm. So it's handling some form of processing load different. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason why I said I'd want to wait for Broadwell. The only thing that gets me, though, is it's on the same chipset.
Right.
That's what kind of hurts me, because then, like, you might not see very much improvement. You know what I mean? It'd be like getting an FX6300 versus an FX8300 or 8320. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, you're not gonna see much in a lot of workloads.
Yeah. So, I'm gonna wait. Obviously, when it comes out, when people start releasing their benchmarking videos, and I can see the actual visible differences, and then I'll make my decision from there. If I don't see very much of a difference, I'm gonna go for the 5820K.
Yeah, especially with the 450 release. That's pretty high.
Yeah, because the 5800K is about $100 cheaper than that.
Yeah, I would say it might be worth like $25 or $50, but $100 is tough.
Yeah. So, and it has a higher TDP.
Yeah.
So it's going to consume more power.
Unless it overclocks better or something, you know, maybe. Yeah. Maybe.
Or thermals or some shit. I don't know. But either way, we can go ahead and end the stream. We've been going for like almost 2 hours. We're bosses.
Oh, shit. All right on.
But, yeah, no, it was a fun week, and we'll see you guys next week. We'll force ourselves to do it, right?
Yeah, thanks for joining us, guys. Have a good night.